Welcome back to my series on building a 3D model of a helicopter. This is now the sixth video in this playlist, and as of today's video, I'm declaring this model is complete enough that I'm going to change direction for future videos. I'm going to focus less on the build and more on helicopter theory of operation. If this is your first time here, the purpose of this project was to create a realistic 3D model of a helicopter, one that has working components that I can use in future videos about helicopters. I plan to focus those future videos on controls, aerodynamics, and drive systems. I've done past videos on these topics, but my ability to explain things was always limited by some odd design choices I made in my early models. Most notably, my first model had a three-bladed rotor system. It's easier to explain rotor control concepts when there are an even number of blades. It's better to visualize the advancing and retreating blades. What you see on the screen now is my best attempt to replicate a Sikorsky Blackhawk helicopter. And I chose the Blackhawk because there's so much publicly available information on the design details, and I needed those details to make a passable 3D representation of the aircraft. The additions I made for today's video are, I added the tail rotor and rigged the tail rotor pitch beam to control the pitch of the blades. I added the non-rotating flight controls to the bottom of the stationary swashplate and rigged these for motion of collective, lateral cyclic, and longitudinal cyclic. And finally, I added the bifilar vibration absorber to the top of the rotor head. Let's go into a little more detail on each of these. The main rotor turns counterclockwise. It takes an applied force to make it turn this way, and it takes quite a lot of force. Without anything to oppose that force, the aircraft would spin clockwise opposite the main rotor rotation. And this is the purpose of the tail rotor, to oppose that rotating force of the main rotor. To do this, the tail rotor blades increase pitch and create thrust to the right and an induced airflow to the left. The tail rotor blades are controllable. Control is necessary because the pilot has to adjust the tail rotor blade pitch anytime the power to the main rotor changes. To put this in really simple pilot speak, whenever you pull up on the collective lever, you have to add left pedal. Up collective increases the pitch of the main rotor blades, and left pedal increases the pitch of the tail rotor blades. Unless you're flying a machine where the main rotor rotates clockwise, there are a few of those out there, and if you're in one of those, then everything is reversed from what I just said. The Blackhawk tail rotor also has this distinctive 20-degree cant. This cant angle provides some vertical lift. 2.5% of the Blackhawk's total lift comes from the canted tail rotor. There are some other advantages to canting the tail rotor. It keeps the blades higher off the ground, which is safer for people moving near the aircraft when it's on the ground. Also, additional lift near the tail of the aircraft gives a wider longitudinal center of gravity range. The bifilar at the top of the rotor mast is a passive vibration absorber. The weights at the end of the arms are free to move. Their distance from the main rotor center of rotation is not fixed. Motion allows them to cancel main rotor vibrations at a frequency that someone at Sikorsky picked. A more technical name for this device is a tuned mass damper. Tuning refers to selecting the weight of the dampers to cancel a vibration frequency of interest. This is probably 4 per rev, although it could be some other frequency. When compared to airplanes, helicopters have a unique challenge of needing to pass flight control inputs from the non-rotating frame of reference into the rotating frame of reference. And this is the purpose of the swashplate assembly. I showed the rigging and purpose of the rotating controls in an earlier video. As of this video, I've now added the stationary controls, which control the non-rotating swashplate. And there's helicopter people in the audience that know I really took the easy way out here. I stopped with these control rods dangling in space before the inputs get to the boost actuators and, more importantly, the mixing unit. The Blackhawk helicopter's control system mixes pilot control inputs in 4 different ways before those inputs get to the swashplates. And this is all done mechanically. If you ever get a chance to watch the upper flight control deck of the Blackhawk, or to look into the control closet of a CH-47 when someone is moving the flight controls, you'll come away amazed and confused at how any human mind could have conceived of something like a helicopter mixing unit. Watching one of these is a lesson in complexity, where the interaction of so many simple things becomes complex almost beyond an ability to comprehend it just by observation. These non-rotating flight controls also represent a new skill that I learned in Blender. Up until now, all of the motions in this model are controlled by drivers. I would start by developing an equation of motion for the thing I wanted to animate, and then I'd add this to the driver editor in Blender. And drivers are still probably the best way to animate many of the motions in this design, but I modeled the motion of the stationary flight controls with inverse kinematics, and this seems like a really cool way to define mechanical motions. Inverse kinematics essentially lets you tell the animated bodies to behave like they would in the real world. You don't need to know the math ahead of time. I probably could have used IK for the rotor pitch control rods, although I'm happy with the way they came out using drivers. I had a viewer question about how I modeled the swashplate motion. I'll hit the wavetops here, but let me know in the comments if there's interest in a more detailed explanation of the animation technique. I used three empties to define three levels of parenting. These were for the spherical bearing, the stationary swashplate, and finally the rotating swashplate. The sphere is a world reference. This establishes the location of the entire swashplate assembly. The next empty is the cube. This is the stationary swashplate parent. And this empty is free to rotate in XY for cyclic change and to heave in Z for collective change. The final empty is the coordinate arrows, and this is the rotating swashplate parent. The parent chain is that the box is a child of the sphere, and the arrows are a child of the box. I then use drivers to control the motion. The stationary swashplate empty, the sphere, is driven by custom properties for collective and cyclic input. The rotating swashplate empty, the arrows, is driven by another empty, which is the rotation controller for the main rotor. And that's it. You may have to adjust the rotation mode. I have it set to auto Euler, but I seem to remember that I had to play around with this to get the rotating swashplate and the stationary swashplate to rotate in the same plane. Here's a topic that isn't new in this version of the model, but a viewer asked about the bearings between the stationary swashplate and the rotating swashplate. When I first started modeling the main gearbox, I actually included some of the bearings. I'll go into the planetary and show how I modeled a double row angular contact bearing. I gave up on this level of detail early in the build. It didn't seem to add much to what I intended to gain from creating the model. You can see that I use a lot of hardware in the model, things like nuts and bolts. I think these add value. They are visible, so they give a sense of depth and rotation. But the bearings are hidden internally. You can't see them, and that's why I stopped modeling them. If we look into the swashplate assembly, I'll hide the bolts and the bearing retaining plates, and you can see this gap between the rotating swashplate and the stationary swashplate. This is where a bearing would go. I would assume, but I don't know for sure, that this would also be a double row angular contact bearing. The swashplate doesn't carry the weight of the helicopter, but the hydraulic forces from below and the rotor loads from above are going to impose some pretty high axial loads. And a double row angular contact bearing would be the most likely thing to react axial loads in both directions while also bearing the rotation. Swashplates are critical parts, so much so that many large helicopters have bearing monitoring systems that monitor and report the health of the swashplate. They measure things like temperature and vibration. These systems tell maintenance when to remove a failing bearing from service. And like a lot of parts on helicopters, the swashplate is important and necessary for continued safe flight. This is the last video that I'm going to publish to this particular playlist, but I now intend to start shifting to educational videos that show the theory of operation of helicopters. Here's a preview of a future topic, and also how I can use animation to explain things more clearly than static images and text. The yellow bars you see on the screen are attached to the rotor blades, and these are velocity vectors showing the airflow coming into each blade element. What you see now is for a hovering helicopter, but as I increase the airspeed, you can see how the forward flight speed becomes additive to those vectors to the point where the distribution of lift will be different on the retreating blade than it is on the advancing blade. This visualization is a cool way to explain forward flight dissymmetry of lift and also to show the retreating blade region of reverse flow. I'm sharing this today just to show the power of animation and visualization for teaching these concepts. There will be a future video where I dig into both of those topics in more detail than I'm doing here. I'm aware that a lot of you have asked questions in this series that I haven't answered yet. I'm trying to respond as best I can, but even when I don't respond, I still get a good idea from reading the questions of where I should go in future videos. I sincerely hope you're getting something out of these videos. I enjoy making them. It forces me to revisit things that I learned decades ago in a way that opens my eyes to new concepts and different ways of thinking. Thanks for watching, and I look forward to seeing you on future videos.